But I want to talk to you today about the most fundamental, beginning, basic thing. It's the point of departure. It's the beginning of understanding what interpretation is, what it can be, and what it can accomplish. And to do that, I'm going to show you some slides, which I'll project, but you all have a copy of every slide, so don't worry about taking notes off the screen. There's little places if you want to write some keywords, you can do that, but don't. Mainly what I want you to do is engage with what I'm saying and to follow my logic, my way of thinking, if you can. If you have any trouble, raise your hand and we'll clarify. Because what I want to try to do today is, I know I can't teach you anything about how to do interpretation. I can't, because I don't know your audiences. And audiences are all determining. I always say in interpretation, in all forms of communication, audiences are the most important thing. In communication, all things are 100% dependent on the audience. So when the audience changes, everything else can change. What failed could work. What worked could fail when the audience changes. And so this is why I say I really can't teach you too much about how to do your kind of communication with your audiences. But what I want to do is to impact your point of view about it. And that's what I mean by the very beginning. I'm going to talk this morning about, and I'm going to have to use this keyboard, right? So we must get this water out of the way, because it's going to go down. Yeah.
This morning.
Yeah. I'm going to talk to you this morning. I'm sorry?
Is it okay now?
Yeah, it's fine up there. Yeah. About what I call the end game. Some of you, have any of you heard, I know at least one person, well, two, has heard me talk about the end game before, three probably, Thomas. What the word end game means, it has two words, end and game. Well, it comes from chess. Are there any chess players in the room? In Sweden, I expect there to be chess players, and I have only one. I always hold you people to the highest intellectual standards. I mean, you're the home of Linné, Angstrom, Celsius. Smart people. And only one of you plays chess. What do the rest of you do?
Work.
Well, the end game is a term that comes from chess and actually was made popular in the 1950s in a play called Endgame, which was about chess and murder. And it refers to that point in a chess match when both players know that the game is over, that the winner and the loser are now determined. They can tell by the remaining pieces and their location on the board that the game is over. Neither one of them can do anything about it now. It's the end game. Have you ever seen a chess match where the two people, experienced chess players, simply get up and walk away from the table and there's still six or eight pieces on the table? It's because they reached the end game and they knew it. It was over. In common language, in English, when we talk about the end game, we say, well, what's the end game? What we mean is, how does this end? What does success look like when some process has played itself out? And when it has played itself out, when it is done and over with, how do things look? That's a question we can ask about interpretation. What's the end game of interpretation? How do things look when you've been successful? And I want to talk with you today about some different ways of doing that, of answering that question. I have to figure out which key to put. Here we go, like this. I've had the pleasure to work all over the world for several decades, over 50 countries. Some of them very technologically advanced and economically developed, like Sweden, and many, many developing countries where there's no electricity, where the people arrive in my classes barely in clothing. The people speak different languages, they eat different types of food, they listen to different types of music, they laugh at different types of humor. Sometimes they even smell differently. Really diverse, until you begin to talk about what really matters. You know, when the conversation turns to those two or three or four, rarely as many as five, key, deep values that people like us share. I feel like I know all of you, even though in most cases we've just met, because I know, because you're here in this room today to spend some time with someone like me, I know some of your values, or you wouldn't be here. These are values we live our lives by. We shop by these values. We raise our children by these values. We vote according to these values. We even dress according to these values. You know the ones I'm talking about. There are few professions on earth, maybe the education profession and maybe the clergy religion, are two. Sometimes interpretation and religion get a little close. They get a little scared when I see the parallels. There are few professions on earth that are as value-laden and value-driven as your profession. Often I'll ask a group of interpreters in one of these places, so why are you in this field? Why did you come to a course called Interpretation for Professionals? What made you want to be an interpreter? It's a fair question, isn't it? Because you are one, or you want to be one. And I've been asking this question for 40 years, people all across the world, and nobody has ever said, Sam, I got in it for the money. Why did you laugh? Because it's funny. Because it's so funny, because nothing could be further from the truth. Isn't that true? Look at you. You have the best education that money can buy. You people are smart. Statistically, you are among the smartest people on planet Earth. You know, I know, everybody knows. You could be using all of your knowledge in a more lucrative field, in a field that would earn you more money, couldn't you? And yet here you are. And so when I continue asking them, why are you an interpreter? What attracts you to this field? Some people at first can't even answer. They just go, well, because I want to. No, there's something more deeper than that. And eventually someone will mention the D word. Difference. I want to make a difference. Someone will say, I just want to make a difference in something. And then some will explore what those differences might be. But how many of you want to be an interpreter because you want to make some kind of difference? I'm serious. Raise your hand if you think you want to make some kind of difference. This is the most basic question that all interpreters have the same answer for. The kinds of differences that we want to make, the kinds of differences we're even capable or in a position to make, can vary, of course, but making a difference through your work, through your communication with the audiences that you spend your time with, is what drives you to do this. Not to make a lot of money, not to be famous or well known, right? We're all going to go to our graves poor and happy, but to make some kind of difference. So let's talk about those differences. Sometimes, And I'm referring here to visitors, but some of you don't have visitors. If you're at Naturum or National Park, or you're a guide, yeah, you think of your audiences as visitors. But if I use the word visitor, you just think of your audiences. These are the people who you communicate with. The kinds of differences typically that we want to make are one or more of three. We want to impact, we want to influence sometimes how those people think or what they think. This is almost always true. We'll talk a lot more about this. It's not to say you want to tell them what to think, but you want to get them to think. You want them to be thinking. And that's a fundamental point of departure that we'll talk about more as we go. Sometimes we're interested in how they feel, what they like, what they hate, what they love, what they care about. A word we use a lot is appreciate. Appreciation is a word that interpreters use a lot. Caring. We want people to care. We want things to matter, right? And sometimes we're interested, not always, but sometimes we're interested in how they behave. You know, I do a lot of my work. I don't know if Anders has told you or if you knew that I'm a communication psychologist. My daughter called me a shrink. A shrink is a sort of a slang word in English for a psychiatrist, right? People used to shrink heads and that anyway, a shrink. I'm not sure. Anyway, my daughter once told her friend says, "So what does your dad do?" I was in the other room listening. My daughter was maybe 10 or 11 years old. And she said, "Oh, he's a shrink that wears earth colors." And I just thought, this is my daughter. You know, she's very creative, I thought, for a 10 or 11 year old. But pretty accurate, except I'm not that kind of psychologist. And I tell you that because I don't want you to bring me those kinds of problems. I cannot help you. I promise you, I cannot help you. I'm still working on myself. However, one of the things I do in my work as a communication psychologist a lot is I work in behavior. I work on all kinds of behaviors, from community sustainability programs in Australia, where I spend a lot of time. Basically, the behaviors there are communicating with people in ways that will get them to use their water and their electricity, right, in more sustainable ways, so behaviors. I do a lot of work in travelers' philanthropy in some of the most amazing places on Earth. I work with National Geographic and World Wildlife Fund mainly in the destinations where they take their visitors, right, and communicate through an interpretive program in ways that increase the likelihood that those people will reach into their pockets and leave more money to support local conservation. Right? It's called traveler's philanthropy, and in fact, I'll be back in Galapagos in November to do that, and to train guides. And in Canada, my wife and I will be in Churchill, Canada, where the polar bears are, with World Wildlife Fund, working on a traveler's philanthropy program for them. I also work on basic national park sorts of behaviors, getting people to stay on the designated trail rather than getting off of the trail and trampling vegetation. Getting people to keep their dogs on a leash rather than letting them run. This is a big problem all over the world. Getting them to clean up after their dogs is another problem I work on a lot, but also a problem all over the world. Getting people to pick up other people's litter. It's not littering, it's if you see litter that somebody else left, picking it up. We've been very successful with that. Getting people not to feed the birds. And getting people to take, in a national park in Australia, take the shuttle bus rather than driving their own cars. Right? So these are the kinds of problems we work on. But these aren't the main things interpreters do. The main things interpreters do fall in those two categories right there. Thinking and feeling. And some people want to call these intellectual and emotional connections. And I allow them to do that, but the psychologist in me silently is kind of laughing because it doesn't work that way. Some people think, how many of you remember the old Star Trek episodes? There was Mr. Spock, left brain, logic only. No emotion. Do you remember this guy? And then there was Captain Kirk, and he was always crying and screaming and very emotional and getting upset. Right? And several episodes showed how neither one could solve the problems. It took both. This was a common theme throughout the series. Right? Well, it doesn't work that way. I'm sorry. As a psychologist, let me just break the news to you. We thinking and feeling aren't different things. We think thoughts that make us feel. We think thoughts that make us sad. You don't just be sad. A thought has to make you sad. We think thoughts that make us happy. We think thoughts that make us afraid. We think thoughts that make us angry. Those are the emotions, right? But they come from thinking. There are very, very rare, almost never does it happen, they're so rare, circumstances where we can have an emotion without any thinking. But it's very, very rare. And when it does happen to people, they usually need professional help. Right? And I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean, there's a classic story of a Vietnam War nurse who saw everything, and she smelled everything. And she had years later, after the war, she had her own baby. It was still in diapers, and she was trying to train it to use the toilet, but it didn't always work out well. And one day, the child had an accident. Number two accident, right? And do you all know what number two is? I think that's universal. Yes. Okay. Yeah. You know, in every language, in Spanish, it's número dos. and he took his diaper off, and hid it in a closet, where she wouldn't find it, right? And weeks went by, and she hadn't found it. But it was a nice, warm summer day. And she happened to open that closet door, and the smell hit her, and she went to her knees, just instantly went to her knees, and began sobbing and crying, and didn't even know why, and they had to call for help in order to take her to talk to a psychologist about what was going on. It's because it had triggered that smell. Your olfactory sense is the most direct of all your senses to your emotions. Maybe you all know, I'm seeing a lot of head nodding, right? And this is what impacted her, without a thought, without a connection. Now, we can also do this in laboratories with mice. We can actually cut the auditory cortex after we've trained them to be afraid of a sound. We can play it a frequency, and every time we play that frequency, we can administer an electrical shock to them. It's terrible things we do to these mice, but this is what was done. And once they were trained to fear that tone, every time you played the tone, you could see them scurrying around in anticipation of the shock. And then, once they were trained, conditioned, we say, then they took those mice and surgically they disconnected the auditory cortex so that they could still hear, but they could not think about what they were hearing. There was no connection between the cortex, which is the thinking part of your brain, and the perception of the sound. And yet, they still scurried around when they heard the tone, even though they couldn't think about it. So this can happen. But ordinarily, thoughts and feelings come in bundles. They come together, right? And so it is not, and I know the NAI likes to define interpretation. You'll see in my book, I did not do that, Thomas, and this is our story. But they talk about forging intellectual and emotional connections. They're one in the same. They are one in the same. And so I don't want someone to say, well, if you're talking about thinking, as we're going to talk a lot about thinking today, but you're not talking about emotion. Yes, I am. In fact, I'm almost always talking about emotion because emotion is what we most want. If you want something to matter to somebody, if you want them to appreciate it, if you want them to care about it, then it really helps if they have some emotional connection to it, doesn't it? Right? And so even though I don't use the word emotion a lot, I'm always talking about emotion and thinking. Are we all clear on that? Did I say that okay? That's pretty good for someone that hasn't had sleep in 2 days, Anders. I'm actually quite proud of myself. Would you give me a pat on the back, Tom? I say, hey, applause maybe. Okay, I need slides. Okay, so those are the three things. It's called the triad. The differences interpreters are usually interested in making are in what people think, what people feel, and sometimes how they behave. That's a lot. I want to talk about these first two more. At the end of the day, if you go out and do your job as an interpreter, at the end of the day, if you would sit back in your room and reflect on things, how would you know if you'd done a good job? What would you even pay attention to? Which pieces on the chess table would you look at, and where should they be? In other words, what's your end game? How would you know? And this has been the subject of a lot of empirical research for the last half a century. A lot of it published in good, respected, refereed research journals. And if you look at all of that literature and all of those studies, right, you see some patterns, right? And what are the end games? What does success look like, right? Because every one, and I'm going to talk about three different end games, right? Then they all have a different idea about how things should look if the idea is that you want your audience just to care and appreciate. To a psychologist, when I see words like caring and appreciation, I immediately see attitudes, because that's what attitudes are. They're the pluses and the minuses, the good, the bad, the right, the wrong, helpful, unhelpful, or harmful, love, hate, like, dislike. That's what attitudes are. When we appreciate something, we're saying that we have a positive attitude about it, aren't we? Right? And so when somebody like Freeman Tilden, how many of you have heard of Freeman Tilden? So this guy, listen, I'm not a big friend, I am not a preacher of Freeman Tilden. I think the man was a genius. Two of his principles were so far-reaching, but the other four, I don't know. And one of them's actually wrong. I'm quite sure about that. And two others, I still can't understand them. And I've been reading them for 40 years. Right? I actually met Freeman Tilden one time when I was a very young university student. Right? And then I just marveled at him because he was on the cover of my textbook. But I didn't really understand what he was saying because his language was so different than the language that I used. And so I don't want you to think that necessarily everything has to be Freeman Tilden. I know there are a lot of interpreters that will tell you that, but I've never been one of them. But I also have been one that has written quite widely about how brilliant he was when he said a couple of things. That unless what you're interpreting connects to the personality and the experience of your audience, of your visitors, you can't succeed. And he also said, we're not trying to teach anything to anybody. We're just trying to blow them away. Right? Right? Those are two ideas that he said that were so far ahead of the research to support them that I have to conclude that this man was like Newton, like Einstein, like Linnaeus, like Angstrom, like Celsius. He's a smart guy because there was no reason for him to say what he said in those days. I'll come back to that in a little bit. Right? But Tilden, right? Just to this is why you can't leave.
No, I'm not leaving.
Good. Feel free if you want. Okay, so this is why it's fair to mention him, because one of the most frequently mentioned nine words by interpreters. Are a quote from, these weren't words that Tilden said, they were words that Tilden quoted from another person, from a National Park Service ranger in the United States in the 1950s, who said, through understanding, appreciation, and through appreciation, protection. When he said appreciation, he's talking about in the sense of having a strongly positive feeling about something, it mattering. And he was just saying if we appreciate something, we would never knowingly harm it. That's all he was saying. That's what he called protection. And in those days, he was mainly talking about not throwing lit cigarettes into dry vegetation. That was really, if you read that chapter in Interpreting Our Heritage, his famous book, you'll see that that's what he's actually talking about. And interpreters today have taken and made that into something different than what Tilden ever envisioned, but nevertheless, those nine words do describe a chain of a series of events that do make sense empirically. And so from time to time, I will cite Tilden. Appreciation, attitudes. Well, if what you're trying to do as an interpreter is get the people that you work with, your audiences, your visitors, whatever, your clients, your customers, and some, if you're trying to forge in them some type of appreciation or caring, if you want what you interpret to matter to them, right? Well, then you might be interesting to know what the end game might be. There have been three that have been studied most. I call them the didactic endgame, and here the archetype would be a teacher, teaching and factual recall. Okay, so the didactic, which means teaching, endgame, and the kind of interpreter you can think of is someone's like a teacher, or someone who gives information, and then there's some expectation that the students will remember things, right? And indeed, a lot of studies have been done where interpretation success has been evaluated based on how much people can remember of the content. Infotainment, you recognize the two words, information and entertainment put together, and this is the entertainer endgame. Right. And then the meaning-making endgame, or also called the provoker. I know that word, for some of you, that word provoke might have a negative kind of feeling for it. But when Freeman Tilden used this word, he meant it in a very positive way. We say in English to provoke thought. There's also another kind of provoking. Provocation, but we don't we need to clarify that's what we mean. When we say something is provocative, right, then we mean it makes you think, right? And so when Tilden said not instruction but provocation, he means we're not teaching, we're stimulating people to think their own thoughts, right? So this is why it's called. I thought you said it was working. But you cannot leave now. You see that. And so let's talk about these three endgames. Each one of them is sort of based on an assumption. And if you look, if you turn to the you don't have this slide. Do you have this slide? Oh, this slide. Each one is based on an assumption. That's what's in italics. This is the endgame. The endgame is that if we can just give our audiences enough of our knowledge, then they'll care like we care. If they know what we know, then they'll care as we care. This is sometimes called the learning leads to loving hypothesis in psychology. It's been tested, and it always fails. I don't want to be the person that pours ice water on a party. But can I just make something perfectly clear? Studies do not support the idea that how much you know will determine how much you care. No studies show that. In fact, lots of studies show a lot of knowledge gain from interpretation and no attitude impact. This is the common result. They aren't really, but do I need to tell you that? How many of you, who are the students in the room? Raise your hand for your student, right? Okay, a couple of you. And are you studying in a natural resource or environmentally related field? Agronomy, forestry, landscape, architecture, okay. Have you learned enough yet now to care? Do you need to be a third year student before you care? How about you? Before? Are you saying that you already cared and that's why you chose to study what you're studying? Doesn't that make more sense? You see, learning doesn't lead to loving. Loving leads to learning. That's what studies have in fact shown, that the more you already care about something, the more you are motivated to learn about it. But the idea that if you learn a certain amount, then suddenly you will care, this idea is made up. It's a lie that we tell ourselves. And it gives us the license, we give ourselves the permission to treat our audiences as if they were students. And we evaluate how well we did based upon whether they can remember what we told them. And so if they can remember our content, we've done a good job. How self-serving is that? I know teachers that are so boring. Have you ever had a boring teacher? You're kidding me. They have boring teachers in Sweden. I thought they were only in my country. Oh, well, this is good to know. We have a lot in common. I know teachers that are so boring. Some of them are my friends, right? Right? So that if you can stay awake in that class, you are a special student. And if you can stay awake, you're going to answer more of the questions correctly on the next exam, aren't you? On the next test, right? And you will be rewarded. And the teacher will say, aren't I a good teacher? Because not everybody can do well in my class. I'm a demanding teacher. Many of the students fail my class. Yes, they do, because they're all asleep. Of course they're going to fail. Do you see what a ridiculous model of education this is? And yet it's going on all across the world, maybe in Sweden, right now, at this moment as we speak. Students are being taught to memorize facts, and if they can faithfully vomit them back on an exam, they will be rewarded for it. And indeed, if you look at 75% or more of all the published studies evaluating the success of interpretation, they're based on how much audiences could remember on a test of factual recall. An A4 piece of paper, however many questions you can get on front and back, right? These are the questions you wanted them to answer, Inga, because you wanted them to know these things, because these things were important to you. And you thought, if they can answer these questions, then I've done a good job, and interpretation has been successful. This is a self-serving lie that we tell ourselves. I'm going to tell you right now, there is one study that shows that the more successful you are in interpretation, I won't tell you which end game yet, but the better you do in one of these end games, we're blue again, the more likely you are to fail the exam, the more likely you are not to answer any questions right. This idea that somehow giving visitors, your audiences, enough information that suddenly they will care, and thinking that we can evaluate how well we did based upon whether they can answer questions that we thought were important about our content, these are just wrong. There's no empirical support, and yet it's the most common way we continue to evaluate interpretive programs, according to the published literature. Why would that be? Well, I have a feeling, having been an advisor of many master's students, not PhD students, but master's students. PhD students are different. But master's students usually have 2 years, about 2 years. And in that 2-year period, you've got to take some coursework and you've got to do a research project that you can do in about 1 year, because the first year is really coursework. Well, how easy is it to make up a test? I just make up a test. 20 questions should do it. 10 on the front, 10 on the back, and I'll give them the test. And if they can answer my 20 questions correctly, I've been successful. And if they can't, then they failed, not me. Right? Isn't this the way that it goes? Right? All right, well, let me just put this one to bed. How much you know has little to do with how much you care. In fact, forgetting is normal and predictable. You've already forgotten most of what I've said today. If I give you a test over what I said in the last half an hour, your distribution would look like that. Some of you would answer some of the questions, a lot of the questions. A lot of you would answer the very few questions and maybe none correctly. And most of you would be somewhere in the middle, somewhere around 70%. And this is what we find over and over and over again. Forgetting is normal. You've forgotten more in your life than you're ever going to remember. You don't have room for it. Human beings are not good hard disks. Our brains are not designed to remember. Our brains are not designed to store information. We've all heard about the amazing capacity of the human brain, but not as hard disks. This is why we invented libraries and museums, because we can't keep it all in our heads. Our brains are designed, what is called our cognitive architecture, is designed to process information. We are like the chip in your computer, not the hard disk. We're the processor, not the storage device. That makes sense? So we're going to forget. And so if we're going to evaluate our success, If we're going to define excellence in interpretation as people remembering what we said, we are setting ourselves up for mediocrity. For that. Not for excellence. We're setting ourselves up for 70%. And plus, there's no relationship between how much people know and how much they care. And so if you tell me you want your audiences to care, if you want them to appreciate, if you want the things you interpret to matter to them, then none of this should matter to you anyway, because knowledge has nothing to do with that. Wrong. Knowledge has everything to do with it. But how much people can remember from what you said has nothing to do with it. So, once all the facts are forgotten, as they will be, if I gave you a test over the first half an hour right now, you would do this well as a group. But what if I waited until next week and gave you that test? Even worse. What if I said, I want long-term impact, and 1 year from now, I gave you all a test over today. How well would you do? I would hope zero. You might get lucky on a thing or two. Forgetting is normal. It's going to happen. And once it has happened, and once all the forgetting has occurred, is there any evidence that something could remain that might look like some kind of difference that you made? Appreciation, caring, mattering. This is a question we have to ask, because forgetting is going to happen. Well, the answer is yes, so we'll come to that. I often in my workshops now, and I actually thought of this in Koster, and I thought, you know, one of the good ways when I train interpreters to get them to envision these end games, these three end games, is I say, okay, draw a picture of it. What does success look like? What does excellence in interpretation look like through that end game? And this is the didactic end game. And so here's a drawing done for the didactic end game. This is what excellence looks like. Here we have a teacher, and the teacher's saying, well done, and everybody's got a gold star. Do you give gold stars in Sweden? No, the gold stars? Gold stars. Teachers in the United States give gold stars for very good work. It says, great job. 100%, and letter grade is A, and we have give A, B, C, D. Do you give it A, B, C, D? Okay, good, we're on. And it's this perfect paper. That's what this end game looks like. It's all the students getting all the questions correct on the test. Let's look at the next end game. This is the infotainment end game. Yes, that is horse manure, and this is a living history town in the Gold Rush valleys of central Victoria, Australia. This place is called Sovereign Hill. It's an outdoor museum. It's one of the best interpreter programs I've ever had the pleasure to work in at a heritage park. And this is Arthur and Louise, and they're just doing a little activation. They call it a little theatrical performance, and the horse in front of the wagon is going down Main Street in this replica town of the Gold Rush era of Australia. Just happened to relieve himself right in front of them, and so they took advantage of it. Here's this end game assumption. If we hold their attention long enough, something's good going to happen, wouldn't you think? And if we can just keep them engaged, you know, keep them entertained, keep them laughing, keep them looking, keep them focused on what we're doing, then something good is going to happen. That's as far as it goes. And you'll see sometimes interpretive programs and interpretive products evaluated based upon how much they hold attention. They're called attention capture and attention holding. Capture and holding. Getting them to attend to it is capture, and then sustaining that attention, that's holding power. Well, okay, I can tell you this. Any successful interpreter is an entertainer. I don't mean entertainment as in always playing banjos and dancing and telling funny stories. And, you know, there are other kinds of entertainment. To a psychologist, entertain means not just frivolous, fun, smiling entertainment. It can also mean a very sad story. Steven Spielberg movies, right? Scary movies. Watching the news tonight, you will see lots of blood and gore. You will hear tomorrow in the newspapers coming out of Stockholm and Uppsala and elsewhere in Sweden. You will see stories about people who are suffering, right? Because it sells. That's entertainment. Entertainment isn't just any, it isn't any of those things in itself. Entertainment literally means holding attention. Entretener, to strongly hold attention. In old French, any Spanish speakers in the room? Entretener is the verb to entertain. Entretener. Entre means between. Tener means to, or have. To have between. To strongly hold the attention of another is to entertain. If you put your hand on a hot stove, that's entertaining to a psychologist because it will hold your attention, will it not? So, to strongly hold the attention of another is to entertain. And so this form of interpretation, or this form, this end game of interpretation, is usually involves judging the success of interpretation by how long it can hold attention. Studies have looked at, do people look at the interpreter who is presenting, who's talking, or do their eyes wander? People have studied, evaluated interpretation based upon how long people read an exhibit text in a Naturum or in a national park somewhere. How long do they spend listening to an audio message, you know, one of the phones you pick up and that sort of thing. And the longer, the assumption is, the longer you attend, the better you've done. Well, I always am quick to point out that maybe... sometimes I don't look at the person who's speaking because that person said something that actually made me think. I might even look down or look up or even turn to another person to say, did you hear what they said, right? So there's one. And of course, if it takes you a long time to read an exhibit text, it could be because it's very poorly written and you have to keep reading the same sentence over and over again, right? But nevertheless, this idea that how long you pay attention, right, is a good sign. Right? Did you recommend it to another person? Did they come back for a repeat visit? These are all the kinds of questions we ask in the entertainment endgame, and they're typical questions on evaluations of interpretation. Right? But again, I just have to point out, if you're looking to stimulate in people a sense of appreciation or caring or mattering, there's no relationship. How long you hold an audience's attention has very little to do with any other outcome of interest. Thinking, feeling, behaving. You must, however, entertain. I can even show you if you, well, you all will have my book. You'll see that I've developed what's called, what I call the TOR model, T-O-R-N-E, right? Thematic, organized, relevant, enjoyable. And of those four letters, three of them have to do with entertainment. The O, the R, and the E. O-R-E, that's infotainment. Right? And so I'm saying successful interpretation is three-fourths, is 75% entertainment. So I'm not saying entertainment isn't important. I'm just saying it's not an end in itself. You know, I mean, think of the stand-up comic, the comedian, who gets up on a stage to tell jokes. And I have 60 minutes to tell jokes. And my end game is to make you laugh for 60 minutes, is it not? I want you laughing so hard your belly will hurt. Right? That's all I care about. I know that my impact ends with the final applause. When I've told my last joke and you've laughed your last laugh, I'm done. I have no more impact on you. I have no more interest in you whatsoever, except that I want you to buy my CD, a T-shirt, and tell a friend to come and see me next week. Right? That's all I care about. That is not the interpreter, though. That is an entertainer who's entertaining as an end in itself. But every interpreter on earth that I've ever met would not be happy saying, my impact ends with the final applause. Because most interpreters I know think that their impact should begin with the final applause. Does that make sense? And so this idea that somehow if you've entertained, you've been successful, is another lie we tell ourselves. We entertain not as an end in itself. We entertain as a means to some other end, as a way to accomplish something else. We entertain for another purpose, not simply to entertain. And again, I'll come back to that in a little bit. So again, once all the infotainment, once all the bells and the whistles, all the laughter, all the crying, all the entertainment has, the banjos quit playing and the jokes have quit being told and all that's ended, is there any evidence that something could remain inside a person's head that would look like a difference that you wanted to make in terms of appreciation, caring, mattering? This is the question I have spent my life's work on. I know it's sad, but I had to do something, right? And so this is it. This is what I've been trying to understand since I was a ranger in the U.S. National Parks and used to give guided walks and interpretive programs to thousands of people every day, every year, never knowing if I was doing a good job or a bad job. If I wanted them to laugh and they laughed, I thought, good job. If I wanted them to cry and they cried, I thought, good job. If I wanted them to pay attention, they paid attention, I thought, good job. But that was as far as my thinking went. But as a young psychologist, I knew there had to be more than that. Because those people were all going to leave. They're all going to go home. They're all going to think their own thoughts. And some of those thoughts are going to refer back to this wonderful place I took them to. Like the whole rainforest. You didn't get to visit the whole, right? But this forest where I used to take people, it had trees from here, the size of redwoods, from here to the wall in diameter. It would take you several seconds, even a whole minute to walk around it, depends on how hard the understory was. Some of them were 1,000 years old. 1,000 years old. What was going on in the world 1,000 years ago was what the seedling would have seen. When you touch one of these trees, it's like a physical connection to antiquity, to something very old and venerable. It would give somebody like me goosebumps. I get them right now, just telling the story. My mom always told me I was special, but I learned. I learned as a ranger, and this is particularly in the summer of 1979, when this thought first occurred to me, so this is why I've been saying almost 4 decades, that not everybody else that I would meet and show these trees to that day would get those goosebumps. I thought maybe I'm even more special than my mom realizes. In communication, all things are 100% audience dependent. Interpreters all over the world continue to talk to their audiences, to interpret for their audiences as if the interpreter were representative of the audience, but we're not. We're weird. I know we're weird because they outnumber us. We're here in this room, and everybody out there is not in the whole world. You hear what I'm saying? So we are this little small, if you go back to the normal curve, this little small group of people had have said, we want to impact, influence how other people think, how they feel, and given the opportunity, how they might behave with respect to the things we interpret. Do we not? This is what we say. Well, do you see the ethical question there? Do you see it? I mean, we have to confront this, don't we? Who are we? We are the minority. We are abnormal. They are normal. There are lots of them, just a few of us. And yet here we are. We're armed with knowledge of biology, of agronomy, with sustainability, with aquatic and marine ecosystems. And we know about cod. And I'm talking to David back there. We know so much about so many things. And armed with all this knowledge, we rather think we know how things need to be, don't we? Don't we? Do you remember that Italian philosopher His first name was Nicoli. His last name started with an M. And he believed this. Actually, he didn't, but he is known for believing this because he actually believed something a little bit different. But his philosophy was, if you know you're right, do whatever it takes. Machiavelli? Ring a bell? His philosophy was, the end justifies the means. If you know you're right, do whatever it takes. There is, in this sense, a little Machiavelli, little voice of Machiavelli in the mind of most interpreters I know. Right? And I point this out because the ethical question is important. Right? But I long ago moved past that. I understand it and I treat it delicately. Right? But I know that if the people really treated this planet the way all of you treat it, this would be a better planet. I know that. I know too much about the science of it, right? And so I don't have a problem with it within certain parameters, right? Which I will end with. How are we doing for time, by the way? All right, not too bad. So here we are, the cutting edge. People armed with knowledge who can see things that normal people can't yet see. And we want them to see things our way and appreciate, right? That's the cutting edge. Of course, there is the other end of this curve. We don't talk about it much. If this is the cutting edge, then this would be called maybe the lunatic fringe. The wackos, the weirdos. You've all heard the terms. I'm sure you have them in Swedish. In the U.S., we'd call them tree huggers, fern feelers. My favorite is earth muffins. These are not very complimentary. Of course, we prefer to see ourselves here. But you know what? History will tell. History will tell. But for the time being, we think we know we're right. Right? Right? And so, just to come back to this question. Right? Is there any reason to think that if we've given people a lot of information, all interpretation involves information, that's kind of like the didactic model, right? Except how much they can remember of it maybe shouldn't be important to us. And we have to do that in an entertaining way to even have their attention, don't we? These people know there won't be an exam. Sometimes the school kids will have an exam, but even in the case of school programs, most of the time they just come to a place to experience nature and not, unless it's part of a biology class, to enjoy it, to have a good experience. Is there any evidence that any impact that you might see as a difference in how they think, how they feel, how they behave, could remain? All right, going to turn our, this is the drawing of the entertainment endgame. Here we have the entertainer. Thank you, thank you, thank you. They're saying bravo, hooray, encore. There's lots of applause. Right? Everybody loves this endgame because everybody feels good. The interpreter feels validated. The audience feels like they were given a good time for their money or for their time. So time well spent. And if you're in the tourism industry, this is what'll make you money. A good time. This is it. This is why I spent so much time working in the tourism industry, because the important thing to realize is that you don't have to make a choice. You can still do the third end game, which we're going to get to now, right? And people can have a very good time doing it, so they can go hand in glove. All right, now is when my sleep deficit is starting to hit me, so I hope I can do this. You always save the best for the last. This endgame, I call the meaning-making endgame, interpretation as meaning-making. The provoker, if you don't like the word provoke, use the word stimulate, to cause to happen, or catalyze. And here the assumption is this. If people in our audiences can make their own connections, then good things can happen. If people make their own connections, good things are more likely to happen. This has been demonstrated through hundreds of studies. Here's a phrase I like to use a lot. If you were going to write down anything I say today verbatim, this would be it. the only caring that any of us can do will be based upon the thoughts we think ourselves between our own two ears. Our caring can come from nowhere else. It has to come from the thoughts. Remember, we think thoughts that make us feel. The only caring I can do will be based upon the thoughts you, as an interpreter, make me think. But they're my thoughts. They're not on your test, some of them. Some of them might be, but a lot of them won't be. That's why I don't do very well on your test. If you gave me a test over what I thought about, rather than on what you thought was important, I would get 100% every time, wouldn't I? This is what studies show. The more you make me think my own thoughts, the less likely I am to be able to answer your questions correctly. The more I lose myself in my own thinking, we would say in common street language, the more you blow me away, the less likely I am to be able to answer the questions on your test. The more I focus on my own connections, the more I'm capable of caring. Studies have shown over and over and over again to the point that this is no longer even really a hypothesis. It is now what is called a postulate. It's a given. It's an assumption we make because the evidence is so clear that the more you make me think, the more powerful, the stronger, the more enduring, and the more predictive of my behavior will be the attitude that results. The more you make me think, the more that kind of attitude is going to result. It's stronger. Strong attitudes predict behavior. Weak attitudes don't. Right? It's enduring. You can't just get me to change this attitude. Attitudes are here and there. You have attitudes about everything. Most of your attitudes are weak and neutral. What's your attitude about this table? Fine. It's neutral, right? What's your attitude about this room? It's kind of a nice room, so slightly positive maybe. What's your attitude about your chair? Is it uncomfortable? Not so good. But most of our attitudes can be changed very easily. Because if somebody with you think, hey, who has more knowledge or more experience tells you differently, then maybe your attitude will change just like that. And this is the way attitudes come and go all the time. But not these kinds of attitudes. Attitudes that result from a lot of thinking. It's called elaboration. Attitudes that result from a lot of elaboration. You know, pondering, deliberating, contemplating, wondering. I love the word to wonder for an interpreter because wondering is the kind of thinking a lot of interpreters are rather like. It's not to have so many answers, but to have lots of questions and wonder about things. But that's elaboration. It's connections you're making. I wonder what my grandmother would have said about that. You see, that's a personal thought. And two people have the same thoughts. And so if you give them both the same exam, neither one, some can answer some questions, one can answer other questions, but neither of them can answer all the questions. These are personal thoughts. This is knowledge, but it's your own subjective knowledge, individual knowledge, not the kind of knowledge you could put on a sheet of A4 paper in the form of test questions. It's what Tilden called understanding, through interpretation understanding, not knowing the interpreter's facts. Too many interpreters think that's what he was saying, Thomas, and it's just wrong. If you read the rest of the guy's book, you know he couldn't have meant that because he also said not instruction but provocation. But he meant your own subjective understanding, your own personal understanding. Even if it's wrong, that understanding is the foundation for the only caring you can do. The meanings you make yourself. You see how different this endgame is. It involves information. It involves entertainment. But what success looks like isn't remembering the facts. And what success looks like isn't simply paying attention long enough. What success looks like is the other person making their own meanings I call them sentences in the head. That's what chapter 6 in my book is about. Sentences in the head. Writing sentences. These are all the morals of all the stories. You forget the facts, but you store the lesson learned, don't you? Remember the lesson, the implication. These are all the impressions you've ever formed. These are all the conclusions you've ever drawn. This is your sense of the so what, the big picture. It's what you take away from it. I always say we ditch the data, which means we forget the details, and we store the lesson learned, the moral of the story. That's what a theme is in interpretation. That's what I mean by theme. There are many critics of thematic interpretation, and every time I read one of them, they're talking about somebody else. They're not talking about what's in that book. They're not talking about what I've researched or what I've taught for the last 40 years, because I'm telling you what I think. I think that the more you stimulate people to think their own thoughts, make their own meanings, the more successful you are. And I can show you 1,000 published studies that will back that up. So that's how confident I am in that. So there are some people that will say that thematic interpretation is talking down at people and talking at them, not with them. I don't mean that at all. All I'm saying is that if you want to be successful in interpretation, you need to develop a story, not necessarily the kind of story Thomas tells, but you need to present information in a way, whether it's oral or written or audio or on the web or a brochure, however you present it, you need to present it in a way that it makes people think their own thoughts. That's what you're after. And at the end of the day, if you want to know how well you did, are you going to measure how much they remember of what you said? No. What you said was always expendable. You said it so they would think. Now you forget what you said and you focus on what they're thinking. That's what success looks like in this endgame. It's people thinking their own thoughts, making their own connections, knowing that the more they think, the stronger and more enduring and more predictive of behavior will be the attitude, the kind of appreciation that can come from it will be more profound. At least has a better chance of being more profound. Not because I'm saying it, because I can show you all these studies that support that idea. And so that's why I get so adamant about this, and I can say with some confidence that the more you succeed as a stimulator of meaning-making, as a facilitator of meaning-making, of connection-making, the more you succeed as that kind of interpreter, then the more likely you are to make the kinds of differences that people like us say we want to make. I already said that. How much you care is based on the thoughts you see. I told you I don't need the slides. I know you like to look at them, so I show them to you. This is how I see the world. These are the sentences in the head. Now, one of the interesting things you're going to learn about thematic interpretation, and some of you I know already know this, is that, well, there are two sides of themes. One is that the theme is the interpreter's tool. If you know the moral of the story ahead of time, it's a lot easier now to tell the story, isn't it? Because you know where the story is going. And so it helps you decide what to say, what to include, what to leave out. This is a really important thing for an interpreter to know, what not to say, and what to emphasize, what to de-emphasize. This is your tool. So once you know the theme, it really helps you to focus and narrow your task. Your job is easier and going to be more effective as an interpreter if you know the theme ahead of time. You can say it in a sentence. But what I've been spending my time on the last 20 years or so as a psychologist is what is the audience side of theme. What happens if you do that well? And I'm the audience. Now what happens in here? And this is what I now can conclude from so many studies, is that if you develop, you have one theme, Thomas, and you develop it well, and you make me think a lot, every one of those thoughts is a theme, my theme. I call them personal themes. And the more of them, the more of those sentences, like sentences in the head, personal theme, same word for the same thing, the more of those I write in here, the more meaningful. Those are meanings I'm making, right? The more meaningful what you're telling me is to me. So the more you make me think, the more meaningful it is. One well-developed theme on the interpreter side can give rise to many themes. on the audience side. One theme can lead to many. And so that's that, and that again, that's chapter 6. I hope you enjoy that chapter. This is what I'm saying here. We are all walking around today as the walking accumulation of all the themes you have ever written, all the sentences in your head, and we're all unique and different. Every one of us is unique and different this way. And if this is you, that's where your caring can come from. And Thomas's caring can't come from there. And Ingeborg, your caring can't come from there. And your caring can't come from there. Mine can't come from there. Only that person's caring can come from those themes. Yours comes from your themes. And there are all kinds of different words we can use to describe themes. In the interpretation business, we use the word theme. But in other places, we use different words. These are morals of the story, all the morals of all the story. These are all the lessons your mother ever taught you. These are all the implications you've ever seen, all the impressions you've ever formed, all the conclusions you've ever drawn. In psychology, they're called schemas. You're all walking around with different schemas. And when you're talking to a group of people, they all bring their own one of these. And you don't care that they all get the same understanding. You don't want them all to be able to answer the questions on the test. That is not your, I mean, you'll be happy if they did, but that is not your main concern. Your main concern is that they do their own thinking at all, so that they all develop this based upon what you tell them, because you know the only caring they can do will come from that. Does that make sense? I'm talking real fast now because I know I'm getting short on time. All right, so this is this guy, Freeman Tilden again. This is the most brilliant statement anybody ever said, I think, in any communication field, because it is so true today. We know that we're not trying to teach, I use bad English for a reason, for effect. We're not trying to teach nothing to nobody. We're just trying to blow them away, lose them in a sea of their own thoughts. If you were reading a very, very good book that you'd been, you know, that special kind of book that you couldn't put down, maybe some of you are reading one of these right now, right? And it's there every night, and every night you're reading it in bed, and every night, I mean, you know, this is, you know, David, you're telling me to read a book that's boring to you to get to sleep. Well, you're right. But this book won't do that for me. When I'm reading this special kind of book, I'm trying to stay awake because I want to get to the end of the chapter, or maybe a whole more, another chapter in itself. And as each page goes by, I start to feel a little remorse, a little sad, because now I can see that this book is going to actually end at some time, and I never want it to end. Can you all relate to that book, right? And so imagine now you're laying in bed, you're reading this great friend, this book, and you're on the last page. And finally, the last paragraph, and the last sentence, and the last word. And you close that book. What happens? Well, in my case, usually everything, once I get to that moment, there's this thought that can only summarize it this way. It goes, wow. That's it. How do you say, wow, man, in Swedish? Can you relate to that moment that I'm telling you about right now? Can you relate to that moment? Wow. Whew. Now, imagine you're in that state. And now I barge into your bedroom with a clipboard and I have a test of the facts. What would your reaction be? Well, first, you would throw me out because I shouldn't be there. I know this. I know this is true. But can you see that these are two different worlds? Your wow moment and whatever questions I have on my A4 paper, these are two different worlds. They have nothing to do with one another. Can you all get that? That's what that man said over a half a century ago. Before there was any evidence to think that. In those days when he said those words, we had a sponge model. We believed if we could just pound knowledge into people's heads, that pretty soon they'd have an attitude. and about 10,000 studies later, might not have been that many, but it sure seemed like it, right? With no results ever confirming that, we finally got rid of that model, the old telecommunications model, where you had a sender and a receiver and a channel and a medium and a feedback loop. Did you guys learn this model in speech communications? And some people still teach it. It's just such a lie. It came out of the military. It's how radios work. In the military, right? Had nothing to do with human communication. And now we know the audience is not passive. The audience does not absorb information. The audience works on it. They elaborate. These studies I'm talking about, right, come from a model of communication that's the most supported and the most studied model in the history of cognitive science. I'm quite sure of that. It's called the elaboration likelihood model. Do yourself a favor, just tonight, get on Google, just put in elaboration likelihood, and you will see, you'll get, I don't know, 50 million hits or something, and you'll see it's applied in all fields, in all communication fields, everything from teaching and persuasive communication to sales, health, communication, advertising, courtroom argumentation. It's used because the studies have had such consistent findings that you hardly ever find in cognitive science. The more you make people think, the better the likelihood that good things can happen if you're interested in attitudes, appreciation, caring, mattering. We're not trying to teach nothing to nobody, Thomas. We're just trying to blow them away. Not instruction, but provocation. Does that sound like you're talking at people or down to them? No, you're a facilitator. You're not a teacher-tell type. You're a facilitator. I just want you to think your own thoughts. And I'll do whatever it takes that's appropriate for the audience and the setting to get you to do that. All right.
So, I think we have to probably round off now if you want to have time for the next
for the exercise?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just going to say, all right, let me just, this is the drawing of the meaning-making endgame. Here we have the interpreter. It says provoker, stimulator, if you don't like that word. I'm glad you're making meaning, she's saying. And this guy is on the ground, exhausted from all the thinking his brain is doing. I can't do anymore. I'm exhausted. Right? And this guy over here, he has the light bulb. In Sweden, do light bulbs come on or do pennies drop? It's different, I find, from country to country. In Spanish, we say, se me cayó la moneda. The coin dropped, like in a vending machine when it's stuck and you keep hitting it until finally the coin drops. So, se me cayó la moneda. In Australia, they say, the penny dropped. And where I live, light bulbs come on. So which one do you have?
Both.
Oh, Swedes go both ways. You're so easy. Okay, so that's what's going on in this end game. Now, I'm just going to quick tell you this story, and then we're going to do the exercise. This is from a financial newspaper. Actually, this was in Australia. I was on a flight from Melbourne to Sydney or vice versa. And reading through the Qantas Flight magazine, I saw this ad for this new financial newspaper. And here it shows all these different people. See up there, it says talk provoking. All these different people have read the same issue of the paper, the weekend edition of the paper. And none of them has read the same paper, really. I mean, because how do you read a paper? Do you read from the top of the first page, page after page after page until the end? Nobody reads newspaper like you browse. You look at headlines and photographs and turn pages and read what's of interest to you, right? And so none of these people has read the same newspaper, right? They all read a slightly different version of the same newspaper. Right? And so if I came in and I gave them a test over the whole newspaper, none of them would do very well, would they? Does this sound familiar to you? This is why I decided to clip this ad out and take a photograph of it, right? Because it shows what meaning making is about. Because every one of them has read something, has attended to something that made them think so much that they now want to tell another person about it. I've always said in persuasive communication, folks in the tourism industry, you all know the importance of word of mouth advertising. Right? When somebody recommends to somebody else, that's the most powerful kind of advertising you can get, even though you're not there to see it. What's thought-provoking is talk-provoking. After you finish that great book, what's the first thing you did the next day? tell somebody, have you read this book, right? I mean, that's, you see a great movie, the next day you want to tell somebody about this movie, right? Thought-provoking is talk-provoking. You have a great experience somewhere, you're going to tell somebody about it, right? That's what TripAdvisor is set up to tap. Every one of them is now provoked enough to think their own thoughts. So much thought that they now have attitudes that is coming from them. This guy says it's fascinating story. I wondered, well, what if instead of reading a newspaper, these were like tourists and had been on your guided nature walk, right? You see the empty dialogue bubbles above their heads? I've always thought this is a good place to start. In the meaning, if you think of interpretation as meaning making, right? Not as teaching and remembering, not as just simply entertaining, but as an entertaining, informative process that is aimed at stimulating people to think their own thoughts. What might some of those thoughts be? What might the moral of the story look like, Thomas, that if I heard them in this discussion, if I was an eavesdropping fly on the wall, what would make me smile? What would make me smile? Every teacher knows that sometimes your students say things that you didn't teach them. They inferred it from what you did teach them. You taught them something, but then they made their own connection to something. And when the teacher hears this, you smile big and you pat yourself on the back and you feel the best of all. That's much better than if they can remember what you said, because now you know they own that knowledge and you were the person that gave it to them. This is what I call a zone of tolerance. You can evaluate, you can know how well you've done in this end game by asking people not what they can remember, not simply how long did they pay attention. Those might be important, but what's really important is if we say we're trying to stimulate thinking, well then the thoughts that people think must have something to do with how well we did, right? So that's the whole idea of the zone of tolerance idea, and I'm actually... Here we go. Are their thoughts supportive and consistent of the differences you're trying to make? If you're listening and what you're hearing is making you smile for the most part, you've done a good job. Their thoughts fall within your zone of tolerance. If they don't, well then you need to go back. They didn't fail. You need to go back and look at what you're doing, because maybe you're saying something wrong or could say it differently, or show it differently, or change your approach somehow so that the next time you eavesdrop in the conversation, you'll be hearing more thoughts within your zone of tolerance. And your zone of tolerance can be totally unrestricted. You must sometimes think, I don't care what they think, as long as they're thinking at all, I'm happy, because I know the only caring they can do will come from the thoughts they think. But other times, and I call that an unrestricted zone, but other times there's some subtle limits. I call it the wide zone. It's really wide and forgiving, but there's often a subtle sort of limit, like, well, I want them thinking whatever they want, but I want them to think appreciative thoughts. If I have an unrestricted zone of tolerance and people walk away thinking that national parks are a waste of money, I'm okay with that. But in the wide zone of tolerance, I'd probably go, no. I'm okay for them to think anything, but not that. And so this is important to be aware of. I used to have discussions with David Larson of the Park Service, U.S. National Park Service, about this, and David was one of the first ones ever to engage with me on this, and that's why after he died, I dedicated my book to four people, my three grandchildren and David Larson, if you wonder who that guy is. And then sometimes it's more narrow. We might have a school class where we say, well, yeah, we thinking anything is important, but these facts are especially important because they're on the test, right? And so there could be that when I do behavior modification, I'm happy for people to think whatever they want. But some of the thoughts they need to think, I have determined from another research process, they need to also be thinking this subset of thoughts in order to increase the likelihood that they'll stay on the trail, that they won't feed the birds, that they'll put money into the local conservation fund, right? So sometimes none of these is better or worse. I just know that the three exist. And so, and probably you could make up subcategories of them. But the idea isn't that one of these should prevail. The idea is that you can't know how well you did in the thought-provoking business until you listen to what people are actually thinking. And then if you're happy with it, you will find out for yourself how wide or how narrow your zone of tolerance is. So there you go. That's it. Now let's take, we're going to do an exercise now, right?
I think you have one last slide.
You want me to show that one slide?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it wasn't, I didn't mean, yeah. Yeah. This was the moral of the story. This is my theme today. It's called the emergent model, in case you read chapter 9. Right? Meaning making is the end game of interpretation. Why? Because there's so much empirical support for it that shows the more you make people think, the more good things can happen that make the kind of differences interpreters are interested in making. End of it. Okay.